Now, you actually worked on the movie Juice.
Yeah. Yeah, so I worked on Juice.
What was your role in Juice?
I came on as a consultant originally. They wanted me to look over the script. The script was written by Ernest Dickerson, who was Spike Lee's cinematographer at the time. And he said, you know, look, take a look at it, see if it makes sense. He had written the script maybe 8 years or so before the movie came out or the movie got greenlit. And so I looked at it, you know, you changed some words up. And I was like, yeah, but, you know, like, give me a title. So I was associate producer on it. And that was the first film I ever worked on. But I feel like without me, they couldn't get the people that they wanted. Like, at that time, it wasn't like a regular thing to shoot a film, a hip-hop film. So everybody was kind of reluctant about it because, you know, we went through, you know, the beat streets and then movies like Rapping and, you know, all of these horrible situations. Beat Street was good, but, you know, some Rapping was like...
You're talking about, not Rapping, talking about Breaking.
Breaking, right. Yeah, Breaking, right. That one.
Yeah.
And we were like, yo, come on, we can't do this again. So we got to be real careful about what we do and how we get involved with Hollywood, because Hollywood really doesn't care. And so nobody wanted to get involved with Juice. The only person they had casted was Tupac. And I knew Tupac. I'd met him once or twice. He knew who I was, so he was happy and excited to meet me. And then you know, they were calling all these people like Queen Latifah, and they wanted to get the Bomb Squad to do the soundtrack. So I called them because I was working with them at the time. I'm directing videos. I'm Ralph McDaniels from Video Music. They all know me. I'm like, it's good. Come down here. I'm here. I'm working on the film. Everybody, come down here and get involved. And that's where it took off. Everything started working from there.
Yeah, I mean, Juice is an all-time classic. I mean, I actually just interviewed Khalil Kane.
Yeah, Khalil, Omar, first dibs. Omar used to,
Epps.
Yeah, yep. Omar Epps used to sing. He was in a group. He had an R&B group, and he rapped too, but he had an R&B group he wanted on the soundtrack. And he was like, yo, Ralph, I'm going to sing for you. So he used to sing for me in the basement of one of those locations, and because the acoustics were right. And he would sing for me, and I'd be like, yo, sounds good to me, but Hank Shockley's in charge of the soundtrack, so go see Hank.
Okay, so you and Tupac were actually hanging out during that time.
Yeah. I took Pac to a bunch of spots I used to go to. We used to go to especially Brooklyn. And, you know, like, I'm thinking that, like, he's from Oakland. You know, he's not, you know, here, but he does have a lot of family in New York. I didn't know that at the time. So, you know, so he was moving around. He would do his thing. I'd go to Brooklyn. I'm like, yo, I got to leave, man. He's like, no, I'm good. Go, check. I said, I don't want to leave you out here, man. He's like, no, I'm good. I'm like, all right. So Pac would go wherever you want and just hang out. And people loved him.
You know, Khalil told me some fairly crazy stories on the set of, you know, dudes getting beat up and, you know, stuff like that.
He invited the wrong kid into the trailer to hang out, and the kid stole some jewelry and got his ass beat. He got stomped out. You know, those are the rules. You know, but at the time, I wasn't working. I had already been shot and killed off. But I took this chick up to the set, you know, just to kind of show her what was going on. And when we got up to the top of the hill, they were stomping this kid out. And she thought they were filming the movie. I was like, yo, come here. You know, I had to take her off to the side.
Anything crazy happened around you and Pac during that time?
Nah, you know, Pac,
or after that time?
Well, you know what? Pac is, you know, he's a ladies' man. So one thing for sure is that dressing room, Winnebago, was lined up with chicks all the time. You know, all the time. And so I'd be like, damn, this dude, I mean, like, it was nonstop, you know, like, they were just lined up. So, you know, and I was like, I would look at the girls and I said, you still out here? You are playing yourself. You know, like, it amazes me now that when I see what, you know, like, fine women and things that they do to groupie out, you know, I'm like, this. So I think that might have been, you know, to see it at a certain level on a movie set. That was probably one of my first times seeing it at that level. And this is Pac now. This is not even Denzel Washington. You know, like, this is Pac. He's not there yet. He's not quite that dude yet, you know? And so, but, you know, that part of it, you know, I wasn't inside. I can't tell you any inside the Winnebago. I didn't get no calls to come up in there, but, you know, it was cool.
Okay. And you worked with Biggie early on, and you're actually from Bed-Stuy yourself, right?
Yeah, I'm originally from Bed-Stuy, and then I moved to Queens, and that's where I met, you know, Russell and, you know, Simmons and them. Yeah, Big, you know, first time I met Big, I remember I was outside Tower Records. Rest in peace, Tower Records. And Tower Records was on 8th Street in Manhattan. And I was standing out there. I just came out, maybe buying some vinyl or something. I don't know why I was there. And this lady came up to me and said, you know, I don't know if you ever met Notorious B.I.G. And so I was like, nah, this is before, you know, Party and Bullshit. It's not even out yet, you know. And so I'm like, all right. So this kid comes over and he's fat and chubby and he's smiling. And there's nothing notorious about what she said. And I was like, okay, nice to meet you. He was like, you know, cool, nice to meet you, man. You know, I've seen your show before, yo, blah, 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 blah. And I was like, all right, fine. And then he walked away. It was all of 5 minutes. And we were getting some Mr. Softies at the time, both of us, me and Big. And so Big walked away. I was with my man Beast, and I was like, why are they calling Notorious B.I.G.? He don't look like Notorious in any way. And so he's like, I don't know. And so 6 months, 7 months later, Party and Bullshit is out. It was like a different guy I met. You know, all of a sudden now he had grown up like really fast. And, you know, not just in the music industry, but just in life. Things had happened, and he was a different guy. His swag was there, his street click was there. I was like, okay, now it looks like Notorious B.I.G. to me, but somebody heard that in his lyrics and knew that was in him. In the beginning, he was just, you know, the girls on the block used to call him Fat Chris. That's who he was. He was Fat Chris.
He was Fat Chris.
Yeah.
And he became Biggie and then Notorious B.I.G. I mean, did you have any idea, like, during the early stages, like, once the music started coming out with Party and Bullshit, like, what was about to happen?
No, I can't. That one I couldn't call. I couldn't tell you that was going to happen. It wasn't until Ready to Die, you know, I was like, oh, okay. It wasn't until, you know, I started seeing him at parties, freestyling. I started, you know, and he wasn't really a dude that would do a lot of freestyles. Like, that wasn't his thing. He would do something written. He wasn't going to just put something out there like that. He studied the game. I look at some of my old footage, and I see him at parties where I had Big Daddy Kane or Dougie Fresh. You know, he studied hip-hop. You know, he was like, when I come out, I have to do it right. So, you know, if you're studying guys like Dougie Fresh and Big Daddy Kane at, you know, their peak, and you're just like 15 years old, and he was in the crowd. I was like, how did he even get in the club? You know, but he was there. Yeah.